What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Business and Biceps, episode 37. Yes. It ain't Monday, but you better wake your ass up! Because on today's show, of course we got John Fosco, but we got Maurice Clarett in the house. Everybody, give him a round of applause. John's in Ohio.
I'm in Ohio. It's snowing. It's not warm, but I gotta say, I'm happy to see all you guys. You guys are great looking people. You're terrific. All of you. You're terrific.
Hey, Maurice has been ripping and rolling on business. It's good to get him back on stage. So we were excited to have him come out. In reality, like, I see a lot of familiar faces here. I just appreciate you guys coming out. John is pushing hard to do this. We're busy as hell with the Arnold Classic. There's no question.
Yeah, for sure. We appreciate you guys so much. Coming out. And this is probably much more enjoyable for us than it is for you guys. We hope to add value, but thank you for coming out. We really do appreciate it.
And the podcast has grown. I mean,
and it can't be stopped either.
It can't be stopped. And a lot of because you guys are sharing it with your friends, your family, and so it means the world to us. But what we want to do is really start with a little round table, just talk about our passion, how we got going, some of the things we went through, how you continue, you know, on the upward trend. And so we're going to open it up with just John's story is unbelievable. Some of you guys have heard it. Maurice's is well documented, but you're going to get to hear it, not from ESPN, which I think will be great. And so I think, or 30 for 30. So I think that, you know, there should be a lot of great takeaways, and we're looking forward to meet you guys after. So, John Fosco, how did it start? Why is John Fosco John Fosco?
I don't even know, man. I woke up one day. Listen, guys, we're going to open it up, like Cor said, for Q&A afterwards. So if anything sticks out to you guys want to push on us, just make a mental note and we'll go deeper. But, you know, I think the reason we wanted to do this is to just talk about drive and success, because it's something that I think we all drive, at least. We're all challenged with daily. It doesn't matter if you're successful, you're a human being. You have to wake up in the morning and find something to drive you. And some of us are born with it genetically, like, you know, the ability to put on muscle. And some of us have to work harder to find it. In my particular scenario, I was just kind of forced into it. And, you know, when you're a kid, you're not aware of what you're exposed to. And I was exposed to rough things, but I thank God that I was exposed to them. You know, I have a fantastic mother, but she was violently abused on a daily basis. And as a young man, I had to deal with that. I didn't really know what I was dealing with until I got into my teen years and I started, I didn't feel like a man. Because my mom was abused, and even though I was 8 or 9 years old, I didn't do anything about it. Now, physically, obviously, I couldn't, but I wasn't thinking like that. So that created a fire in me that I didn't choose, it just did. That also created some problems, and the biggest was a drug problem. I became addicted to prescription pain medication, and it almost took my life, but it was the biggest blessing I had in my life, because once I beat it, what I found is that the gifts that were given to me by God, I was able to utilize, and that is business, negotiating, and deal making. And, you know, we all have a story, and I don't believe in the perfect family, right? I don't believe in, you know, the Joneses. I think we all, excuse my language, I think we're all fucked up in our own way, straight up. And I think it's what you do with it. And we can all be mad at the world, we could all be mad at our family, we could all be mad at parents, or we can own it and do something about it and not hide from it. The worst thing we can do is push things under the rug, because that really damages us. So for me, my outlet was business, because I enjoy it, and I'm naturally good at certain parts of it. So That's kind of where my passion started and the root of it.
I don't know how to follow that up, right? So what was the question? Where does the drive and passion come from?
Yeah, just the fact that, like, when you get up every day, Reese, and I'll tell you one thing that impacted me, that, you know, as we became more friends, when you talked about a bullet coming through your house at 9, that you can't ever understand, you know, ever not see that.
Yeah,
it just is, but just something like that.
Yeah, I mean, I think naturally when you come up, I'm from Youngstown, for anybody who doesn't know, and naturally Youngstown is impoverished, violent, you know, you're always trying to get out of it. You know, as a kid, you look on TV and you have ideas of you want to leave or how do I get out of this space, and I think it's no different from you seeing your mother abused, but you also see different killings. You know, like I was 8 years old and I seen the first guy get killed, 9 years old, your house getting shot up, 10 years old, guys getting killed in your front yard and all the stuff being around you. And I think it sparks something up in you. It's like a drive, and I'm not sure when you're that young, you know where to put the energy. You know what I'm saying? And for me, you're like, I always want to start just like this false sense of bravado. You know, like even weightlifting is like a false sense of bravado. Like you're big and tough, but you're really taking that energy elsewhere and putting it into weightlifting or conditioning for training. And that started for me with wanting to do it in football. You know, and football brought me an identity. Football brought me friends. Football brought me some form of social importance. I was important to people again, you know, and sort of that energy that he's talking about, he's trying to put it somewhere. And another part that I can identify with him about, just when football or that thing was going for me, that other place I found was with drugs and alcohol and abuse and all that stuff. And really, you're trying to find another place to put that energy. And even when you told me about this, I was in the weight room and I was like, man, people have no clue. The weightlifting helps to keep my life on track. You know, just getting up in the morning, working, focusing your energy towards something, spiritually living in the moment, being focused on taking care of my body. And some people may look at it on TV and say, hey, you know, it's cool that a guy looks that way, but it's really more behind the story. You know, and everything I've ever tried to do, be it with business or be it with something productive that you put in your life, all these things that people believe help you to drive you, they essentially help to keep you on track. I'm pretty sure even yourself, but like when you're looking at a deal or when you engage in something important, it's just this place to lay your energy to express how you feel about life. You know, and I don't know what it is. I don't know how all of this stuff happens. I don't know how, you know, I don't know if God puts that on you to be responsible, to be in front of people and in the public and do that stuff. I don't know. I love business the same way he loves it. I love deal making. I love being engaged. I love fighting. I love lifting weights. I love just chasing something. I don't know where it comes from, and half the time I beat myself up. I have no clue, but doing it keeps me on track, and it kind of keeps me evolving as a person. It's finding out how much more can I accomplish, how far can I push myself, how far can I go, how much can I believe, and so on and so forth. And I think, like you said, everybody's a little bit messed up, but what do you do to, I don't know, level out? You know, some people have weightlifting, some people have business, some people have, you know, different things, but that's sort of like where my thing started. I don't know if that answers your question, though.
Well, I know both of you well, and you're both so competitive. I think that's part of where it comes from. Yeah. Reese don't want to look, like we had a charity kickball tournament, right? And we were losing, and Maurice huddled us up like, I'm not losing. Charity kickball, like 5-year-olds. Like, we played a charity football game every year. Reese is like, hey, I know it's for charity, but it's the fourth quarter.
Yeah, like, and I like to win. What about this? But I think losing is a mentality. I think you just become comfortable being a loser. Like I said on Instagram today, like you just become comfortable with making the wrong decision.
Yeah.
Like you just, like if you know, like you go on, like even if something small as this, like if I know I'm going on a trip and I'm on it for 30 minutes, I feel like a failure if I get off at 27. You know, so yeah. I think you can kind of condition yourself to become a loser just in subtle moments. You know, just subtle, like even it was easy for me to say, Corey, I don't want to do this tonight.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because I've been up for 4 days, 6-hour trips, 4 of them up and down the road, but that's like conditioning yourself to be a loser and say, I quit at something. And that thing shows up in other spaces in your life, you know, so. Yeah.
My thing was, and I put a video on Instagram the other day about, I try to also put that pressure on yourself, like you can't get off at 27, you get off at 30. John always talks about how he puts a lot, he makes these things up in his head that creates pressure so he can deliver. For me, it was like, I really didn't have anybody to look up to that did what I did, or did what I wanted to do. And so I finally just thought like, well, I guess that guy has to be me. And so there's no game plan. no one could tell me how to open a gym. The guy that I knew that opened the gym, he had another job. He couldn't even make a full living off of it. And so it was like, no one's really paved the way, so it was like, now it's time for me to pave the way. And when you kind of take that on, you're in uncharted territory constantly. And so what I really loved about it was, I mean, I really didn't have nothing to lose. No one was teaching me how to do it. If I messed up, that was my teachings, and no one expected me to do any of this. There's no expectations. Because when I told people, like, at 165, no abs, no money, thinking I'm gonna be on the cover of magazines, own a gym, do the things that a lot of you guys have seen me do, man, no one even had a clue it was possible. So it, for me, it was like, not only about that, it was like, when I accomplish things through my passion, what's gonna happen is hopefully, you know, I can impact a room of people like this. Hopefully I can change generations of Gregory's through that. And so once I found my wheelhouse, I really didn't care what people thought, but there was no plan. I had to create it. And so you find like you're in this space all by yourself and no one really believes it except for you. So it's a little lonely at times. I tell a story about how I was in college. Well, I really didn't go to college, but I lived at Ohio State. As Reese, you went to college.
Short-lived.
Yeah. So it was like one of those things where, you know, I came home one day and they're all sitting around the table and it looked like an intervention or something. And they're like, we need you to sit down, G. I'm like, all right, what's up? And they're like, I lived with like seven guys at that time. And like, well, you're not really partying with us on Thursdays no more. And you know, you're at your girl's house all the time. I was already hooked up with Rage. And you're, you know, I'm running flyers off on Saturdays for my business. I'm not at Panini's on 12th or whatever. And I just had to explain to them, like, guys, I know we're all still kicking it. I'm 20, but I'm trying to open a business. And like, but you don't know what you're doing. And they weren't being mean. They just didn't understand. You know what I mean? And so I was like, look, check this out. I've allocated one day to party with you guys because I am still 20, but I'm embarking on something that I believe and has changed any of those dudes that have been associated with me. But it just, I was literally 5 years ahead of everybody. So like I said, it's a little lonely, but don't be scared to be that guy for your family or your industry or you, because it's gonna take a while till people can connect the dots. They're just now, I talked about Rachel, about her dad, like he thought I was crazy. He's like, this kid's coming to date my daughter in a wife beater, says he's a coal miner, personal trainer, want to be model. Like, do you want me coming to your house? Right? So I'm their hat backwards beater, like I'm feeling good, right? So yeah, bodybuilder. So you know, it's gonna take a while. He's just now believing, I think, but yeah. It's just one of those things where it takes a while, but don't be scared of that, because that's what I think eventually can become great. That's the key. So John, now that you're rolling, how like you found what you love, which is business. Mm. Now what a lot of people, and including us at times, we fight is the action of now taking that and like next level. Because everybody's always like on the plateau of going next level, right?
So. Right. So, you know, with me, it was business. With you guys, I think it's very important. Put your parents aside, put your family aside, and think clearly about what your gift is. Because so often we are influenced by expectations and we don't give ourselves a chance to really know ourselves. And if you can get that fog away, you can realize who you are. And we all have something that's very special. And to answer your question, I had the ability and have the ability to excel in the art of the deal, call it. Yep. And once
I've seen it firsthand.
Once I realized that, I didn't say, oh, business is marketing, it's operations, it's legit. No, I said, okay, I'm good at this. All right, I'm gonna focus on this and just get really good at it. Because so many people, and I suffer from this a little bit too, want to do so many things. When, if you are truly honest with yourself and you can grasp that thing that you're great at, that's what you have to cultivate. Because that's where you're going to make an impact and make real moves in life. And once I understood that, and I put all my time and energy into saying, okay, how can I study psychology and get better at sales? How can I dig deeper into the mind and understand behavior patterns and body language to make deals? That's when I started to expand my ability to succeed. So I really believe for everybody, first be honest with yourself. Okay, clear out all the voices, whether it's your mom, your girlfriend, your boyfriend, clear them all out. You know what's in you. You gotta be faithful and honest to that. Once you get there, and it may take a while to get there, once you get there, zero in and make it your focus, because that is where you will excel. And that is how I did.
Reese, I think it's two parts for you, because once we, go ahead.
I think, like, it was just funny, I was listening to you, but he said the same thing that you said that you did the first time, like you became focused and driven about and believing in yourself that your gifts was what they were. And then he said that's how he became good, he became like a believer in that. And I think that kind of like happened in my life, but that's a whole different story.
But well, I think.
Hopefully, did you understand?
Explain, Reese.
So you said you had a tremendous amount of confidence from wanting to be a personal trainer, coal miner, and a bodybuilder, right?
Yeah.
Essentially, what he just said was the same thing. He just said, I found out what I was good at, and I honed in and I focused on that regardless of what anybody said. He was saying, block out the parents.
Yeah.
Basically, you blocked everybody out without even knowing it.
Yeah, no question. Well, I think that's what goes to you, Reese, is like when you came on campus as a freshman, no back had ever started at Ohio State as a freshman. Tell them the mentality that you went, because Maurice's work at that point was just unparalleled.
No. It's funny talking about it now because I try to come across more humble. But what I did when I was a freshman, I went there.
Tell them the real story, Reese.
Yeah, no, I went there and I just told the guys, and I believe it. I really believe it. Even if I do something now, if you catch me in private or you catch me lifting weights, I'm a lot more arrogant. But no, I think you have to be. Like, if you're trying to accomplish anything, and I can only speak directly, you gotta have like a fuck you mentality. You know what I'm saying? And sorry for the kids. I hate to say this in front of kids, but everybody here is.
It's my kids. It's okay. I'm sorry. They're used to daddy on.
Yeah, I feel bad.
You're good.
I work around kids, so I'm like, yeah. Man, like you're conscious of how you speak. And but you know, I went in and I wrote the goat on my sneakers or on my cleats. And I would look at it, and I would believe that everything that I did, I had to be the greatest of all time. So I asked myself, how does the greatest of all time lift weights? How does the greatest of all time watch film? How does the greatest of all time prepare and train? Essentially, what you were doing, digging down into who I'm supposed to be or who do you really believe that you are. And I said it, I keep on referring back to Instagram, but I don't think people take belief serious enough. Like, your fucking belief can, like, fuck what anybody else think about it. Your belief can just take you to anywhere you want to be in your mind. I think like life is supposed to be lived from your imagination. Like you imagine yourself being this fucking, you seen what you wanted to do. You know what I'm saying? And I think so much of life is supposed to be lived like that and not really worrying about expectations. And so I told these guys with full confidence, you know what I'm saying? I think like a lot of people are comfortable competing in silence, and that's like real corny to me. But like I can say, hey, I'm gonna whoop your ass. So now it's on the table that we gotta put out there. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're serious. If you say it, now we have a level of accountability, like who's gonna prepare better, but it puts it on the table. You know, but you can have people who wanna compete against each other, who wanna get business, who are scared to put themselves out there. And I just wasn't scared to work, and I was looking at these guys like, man, I don't give a shit who y'all are. Y'all not gonna outwork me, because I'm gonna put the work in every day, put the accountability on myself every day, and I'm gonna get the job done. And from that, it like raises the bar up, it makes him better. And then now we're not, like we can casually be friends, you know what I'm saying, but I'm trying to be better than you, you know what I'm saying? And so, like that's the only way you get better, like all the like the shake hands, high fives, fuck that. I'm trying to be better than you, I'm trying to win, I'm trying to do more business.
And you tell them they wouldn't get back on the field if you got on Reese?
No, I just told them if you lose your opportunity, but that came from preparing so much, you know, so much film, so much weightlifting, so much condition. I think the more that you put into something, I just think the world pays you. Like the world pays you for what you give to something, like from your heart, your spirit, your mind, whatever you dig into, like whatever you just invest all of your shit to, I think the world like rewards you a space for it to be recognized by everybody else. Like, this guy has put more work in, so this is what he has delivered. And I just think, like, when I look at it from a spiritual standpoint, looking back, I just think I dug more, and from whatever harvest or whatever seed I put to the ground, I harvested that, and I had that level of success. So I think whatever you do with that success when you get it, that's, you got to steward it the right way. But I think that's what kind of comes from it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so it's like one of those things where I always just believed that if I was full go all the time, that work was put in, that I could see, even though the vision was only clear to me, that I would put that pressure on myself that if you don't get up at 3, 4, like basically you're a chump. I would put the pressure on myself. Like, I knew about the consistency because I wasn't a gifted athlete. I didn't have all these things laid out for me. That if it was just about work and attaining that period of time, that I could do it. Because we all can. That's it. I mean, we could all set it up for ourselves. I didn't know how long it would take, but I was willing to put the time in for however long it would take. Is it gonna take 1 year for my gym or 15 years for my gym to be successful? Is it gonna take 1 year for my supplement brand or 10 years? You know, we just started a new one. Is it gonna take, well, it's been pretty successful already. We're doing good, but to the level we want to take it to, we don't know how long it's going to take, but we're prepared. I think a lot of people get caught up in, man, that's just such a long road. But you got to enjoy that part.
Get ready for that long road.
Yeah, that's his
part. It ain't getting shorter.
Yeah, I mean, one of the longest roads has been Maurice's, from where he was at to back to where he's at now, building $1 million business. And you can just see that it's, here's the other thing, like, it's like, yes. I mean, all the time, everybody's life is that way. I was stressed out as hell earlier today, all the stuff we got going on. Because I wanted to make sure I could come. I didn't go to the gym this morning. I just went to the track. I slept 3 extra hours because I didn't want to be tired for you guys tonight. Because this was so important. You know how many gym sessions I miss? Like, none. If that tells you anything, I was like, you know what? You know, so that's the thing is, like, I'm so excited about the things that we do, that we're going full effort all the time. I don't look like there's a day off. And so if there's no days off for that period of time that Reese did, that Fosco's done, that I've done, it's just time involved. How long? And are you willing? Because there's those stories about the guys that are mining gold and then they stop because it was the seam was 2 inches to the left. And the guys that came and bought all the equipment, it's in Think and Grow Rich, mm-hmm. right, Reese? Mm-hmm. Guys that come and buy all the equipment for half price, they just moved to the left. And they spent 2 more days, and they had billions. A lot of people just quit too early. I mean, I think, right? And that's big.
I mean, consistency is everything. And what you were talking about with your goal, what I liked about it is you didn't talk about time. You talked about, I'm going to do this.
It's daily.
And I think the biggest mistake people make is with a large goal, whether it be personal or business, they try to measure the time they're going to put in. It is fucking impossible, okay? Yeah. There's so many variables that like hit you like hooks that you better be ready for, and it's always going to be longer and more arduous and more painful.
That's a big word.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. I like it though.
It is going to be longer though. That's the thing. Like, it's going to be way longer than you want it to be. I always talk about 2 things. I thought I was the coolest personal trainer in Pataskala, Ohio. No one knew, way before the internet. Like, I was like, I don't know why, you know, no one knows me. I'm so sweet, whatever, right? I used to think that all the time because I wasn't teaching nobody except for these 20 people I had. I wasn't pouring into the world. I wasn't doing the things that would allow me to be the person that I am today. Like, you can be pushing, but you got to really like, think like, how can I get in action to that next step?
It's important. So I spent from 2006 to 2010, I was in prison. And a lot of people identify prison as like what you see on TV, you know, a bunch of monkey bars and a bunch of people who swole. You do have that portion of it, but a lot of that is not the total picture of it. You know, you have a lot of guys who go and they take a bunch of psychosocial rehabilitative coursework and they repair their brains, repair their minds, get structure, discipline, and they figure out what they want to do after they're released. So I gravitated to the people who are more structured and disciplined and and people who are trying to do something, you know, I knew very early that I was like, this isn't for me. I can get through this period, but this whole prison deal, this wasn't something that I wanted to repeat, so I aligned myself with people who were better. And the thing that I saw about the people who had the most amount of success in prison and who weren't even thinking about coming back were the people who woke up early, that would get up before the rest of the crowd would get up. They would work out, they would read books. Guys came out to the day room, like which would be like a facility like this. They would either be locked down or doing something different, or they were out there on their own schedule. And the more you've seen it, these guys would be more at peace. These guys would be just like totally focused in on their zone. And I think that if you see even successful entrepreneurs now, they just function on a different clock. You know, people who are just different and successful, they don't function on the world's clock. It's just some shit that they create that they stick to. And it's just that discipline that you create and basically stick to over time. And so when I came out of prison, that clock, that internal clock that I had of just getting up early, handling my business, doing my thing, I didn't quite know how to make it stick when I first got out because I didn't have an occupation. I had a direction, but obviously I needed to raise some capital before I got into what I wanted to get into. But it was always just trying to land that discipline. You know, just like, how do I, like anything else, how do I get like a, what are my core things that I do every day that keeps me in balance? You know, like if mine is working out, listening to an audio book, listen to something constructive. You may talk to a few different people. You may read, you may write, you may do something that just keeps you like kind of tuned up. And you know, it was just finding that thing. And then, you know, obviously you find different stepping stones to obviously get to the point where you can be an entrepreneur. I'm pretty sure everybody's done something to help them raise a couple extra dollars or do something to get to the space that they finally want to be in. But that's what it's been all about. And even now, still till then, like me was talking about just knowing the path, and I can speak from personal experience right now, just building a mental health facility, an alcohol and drug treatment facility, you're going to go through so much in business that you don't even expect. But like, do you get pissed off or do you figure out like, how do I solve this problem? And then like always like solving problems, figuring shit out, but having that same discipline or having those same things to kind of keep you, I want to say locked in, but just keep you on a productive path. And I don't know, it's just a rhythm I created. You know, I think everybody in here who's trying to do anything successful have to find their own personal rhythm.
You know, like that.
Yeah, I mean, just your personal rhythm.
I think that a lot of you guys that know me, I preach the daily strategy. Personal rhythm is the same way to explain it. I think that everybody has something that just makes them feel like, when I walk out of the gym, I feel like I can conquer the world. And then when I get a chance to listen to Reese, John back, you know, with Business and Biceps or ET or whoever I'm listening to, like that gives me more confidence because I'm developing myself. Then I go and I'm training at the track and I'm listening to more. It's like I get to 7 o'clock and I feel like no matter what fire John and I got to fight that day or what we're trying to do creatively, I think that's the other thing. I feel, even though I'm a trainer, but I'm an entrepreneur, which gives you a creative spot, like to create a brand, to create things, like that gets your mind at peace when you're developing it daily. And that strategy, whatever that is for you, you gotta find it. And if it takes you 5 years to find it, the next 5 years will be even more productive. But along the way, you're gonna learn so much. And so I think like finding that literally is probably the key of why I'm me. And once I honed it in, I just felt literally unstoppable. Truly unstoppable. So if you don't know, if you're sitting looking at me right now and you don't know what your daily strategy is, then you need to figure it out starting tomorrow. Because the way you get from sitting there to sitting here is a long term is by doing that. That's the key. Because I'm just like religious with it. It's a non-negotiable for me, except for this morning. But I still worked out. So it's like, it's truly non-negotiable. And Rach can vouch for this. Like if I'm like, in some way I can't train in the morning, I don't get a chance, it's like me time, it's selfish, but I get up at 3 a.m. so I can do it, so no one can really say anything, but it's like I try to get it all out of the way before John and I talk about business, before the kids are out of bed, before Rach is out of bed, like I'm trying to get it all done because I need that to be Cory. And if Cory wants to be productive so he can do all these things he wants to do for his family and make his business right and help develop people, I need that. And if I don't have that, I'm just not, it's not me. And so I think you guys need it too. We just got to figure out what that is. It's huge. It's huge.
Yeah, the one thing I would say as we're talking about kind of finding our niche and developing ourselves is vulnerability is something that scares, I think, the best of us. I think it scares all of us. And when you follow your inner truth and what you know to be true and what you want, you're vulnerable, right? Like even us sitting up on this stage right now, you know, I could have friends back home and say, oh, this guy thinks he wants to be Tony Robbins or this or that. I mean, like, you're vulnerable always. But at the end of the day, guys, like, you live your life, and the people who support you for following your heart are the people who belong in your life. The people who don't, you may want to take a second look at, but do not be deterred because you feel vulnerable. We all feel vulnerable, but the biggest, I think, mistake, I would say, is to not step up to the plate because you feel vulnerable. I know that's something I struggled with a lot when I started just speaking. I'm naturally an introvert. I don't talk to many people at all. And this is, it was a lot more difficult for me. But when you guys, I mean, if you guys are looking for something, if you guys are on a path, just stop worrying about what anybody else thinks. Because if they really do love you or care about you, they're going to support you regardless. And that's what I believe matters.
No, man, I would build on the same thing. I forgot what you was talking about before, and I was going to add on to
it. Daily strategy stuff, Reese?
Yeah, this is weird, but when you were talking.
Is it weird, Reese?
You know, because one of my favorite shows to watch is Oprah, like Soulful Sundays. It's weird, right, in the weight room.
Maurice Clarett watching Oprah in the weight room.
No,
okay, go ahead.
Weird here. We're talking about Oprah on Business and Biceps. But I was saying that Oprah was talking about you got to fill your cup up before you give it to somebody else. But kind of like she was talking about mind, body, spirit, finding your rhythm or taking time out at 3 in the morning to give Cory to himself, or this is what Cory gives to himself, now I can give something to the rest of the world. And I just want to add on to that. Like, you know,
that's a good way to explain it. That's a good way to explain it, because I think the uninterrupted time is so valuable that people, they get so busy in their life. Like, I really believe if you sleep even one less hour and give that time to yourself, you're just going to feel more whole. Because you need that. When you get older, you get busy, you get kids, you get a family, you get a business, Abe's got multiple hospitals. Like, I mean, you just get busy. So you can go through the whole day and not have any time. Like, I fall asleep, you know, at 10. Rach gets to watch whatever shows she wants because I'm knocked out. That's her time. You know, everybody needs their time to do so it makes them feel like a person still. Because you can get sucked into the world so fast. I mean, and it's just like 10 years go by, and John always talks about you'd be looking at the same walls.
Yeah, without a doubt. And I think that comes down to whether it be a partner in a marital relationship or a business partner. You must maintain your individuality and protect it, because if you're going to be involved in a healthy relationship, interpersonal or business, like, I got to be John, Corey's got to be Cory. We can't be the same guy running a business, because then we're just one. Want to know what's a lot more beneficial? Two minds that sometimes think very differently, because it creates, you talk about rhythm, it creates a rhythm where different ideas are constantly coming in, and because we've built a level of trust, they gotta run through a filter. So only the best ones make it through. So when he brings up some stuff that I don't agree with, I know we have the same goal. So I respectfully hear it, because I wanna hear it, because he has great ideas. And I think, like, when you have a relationship with a person, like, that has to be part of it. And I have to respect the fact that he wakes up at 3, I wake up at 7. I go to bed at 1, he goes to bed at 9. I like to work at
10.
Night. Yeah, I like to work at night. That's when I'm creative. He's creative in the morning. I'm not going to try to force what I do on him, because that will take away what makes him him. You know what I'm saying? And I think when you're working with anybody, you really have to respect them and not enforce what you do on someone else.
Reese, I want to ask you one thing too. One thing you talked about, like, making yourself not come here because you didn't want to come here, but just like getting out of the comfort zone. I think not only are people scared of what other people think, but it's the uncomfortable, it's the unknown, but that's where the breakthroughs are.
Yeah, and that took a lot, even when you were talking about getting on stage and speaking and being vulnerable, and that essentially gave me one of my largest platforms, and I don't even know the science behind it, other than like getting out of, sort of getting out of your own way, you know what I'm saying? And just really sharing yourself with the world, like as corny as it may seem, like I sound crazy and corny saying this, like I just think that's what the world is, just giving yourself to people, you know what I'm saying? And naturally just sharing, like this is nothing but an idea you're sharing with people, you know, supplements is an idea, training is an idea, and I just think more of life is lived like just by sharing yourself and who you are and your vulnerabilities and just your truths with other people. I always say this, man, I think like the only thing that you have is like the truth of your life. Like when you can become comfortable just speaking the truth of your life or being vulnerable or being out to people.
That's when you're like, free, I think.
You're free, but you break through. You know, you break through because now I don't have to care about how he feels about me or how they feel about me. And so much comes from vulnerability. You know what I'm saying? And you can just ascend to new levels or you open up new doors for new conversations to be had. You can, even when you become vulnerable before, like you can just dive in deeper with people. And the relationship has more depth and value, and you go further places faster. But if you live your life with a bunch of these, like, how do they feel about me? All these strong guards up. I gotta wear the cool outfit. I gotta wear the suit to come and speak, or I gotta present myself a certain way to be perceived a certain way. You just hold yourself back from so much. You know, I just think that the more honest you can be, the more truthful you can be, the more vulnerable you can be, the more open you can be. I just think you just start to just ascend to different levels, and just more the world opens up to you. If that makes sense.
I'm glad you're wearing a Timberland and not a suit. So
I've been wearing suits all week. I'm tired of suits.
So, Johnny, I think last kind of subject before we take some questions would be, like, you already had success. How do you keep pushing forward? Reese, you're having success. How do you keep pushing forward?
So, for me, it's grabbing onto something and following my truth. You're going to hear me say truth a lot because I would almost call it my religion, but ultimately, my mother, someone, all I have to do is say my mother, and that will motivate me to run through a fucking wall. Like, that's it. That's all I need. Now, I combine that with what I believe I'm capable of. I'm not there yet. I got a lot to learn. 5 years ago, I was completely different than I am now, and I hope that trend continues. But if I believe I'm there, I'm cheating myself. I'm lying to myself, and I'm cutting myself short, and that's where those valleys come in, right? Once you get comfortable. I do not believe in being comfortable. I'm not saying stress yourself out. No. I'm saying, okay, I'm at this place. How do I improve? Now I'm at this place, it's time for the Jaguar, right? It's how do I improve? And you should always, like you said earlier on, I create situations in my head for business, I admit it, that are almost warlike. Cory knows it. If you compete with us, I find a way to, in business, hate you. And I find a way to want to.
You guys are similar there.
Yeah, just take you out. And I create it, and I know it's dysfunctional personally, but in business, I believe it's okay. I think deciphering those two worlds is very important.
I don't do it well. Yeah. I don't do it well.
I think the other thing, too, is that. You know, if you got all those things in line, your strategy's good, your drive's good, like, for me, it becomes, like, legacy now. I feel like I've created a good, you know, life for my family. We've been able to start impacting people. Now it's like, I want this to go to the level that the fitness did, because I just know the amount of people. So there's always going to be probably something else. It's another store. It's more employees than Jacob. There's more, right? There's always more. But it's like, I want people to know I left my mark. I always talk about, you know, I wanted my kids to hang a poster of Daddy on their wall. Like, funny thing, Muscle Farm, we had a poster. I was on it. Colin Kaepernick was on the other side when Cap was you know, good or whatever. And like my son hung a cap first. I was like, you know, like your dad's on the other side. Like, can you throw it up? So, but I mean, at the end of the day, like that's the kind of stuff that I used to like make up in my head that seemed ridiculous to most, but happened. It seemed ridiculous for Maurice Clarett to walk on the field as a freshman and have literally probably the best season a running back maybe ever had and brought a title back to OSU. It was huge. It seemed ridiculous to John to come from basically almost dying to start an MMA stock, which then sold for seven figures and went into VFD and now into what we're doing now. Like, they seem ridiculous, but everybody goes through these adversities. Like, I was tired of living in a trailer that costs $100 a month rent. I was just tired of it. You just get tired of it. And finally, something will push you over the edge that wants to make you great. Right?
Absolutely. And what I'll say is, you know, when you're picking your team, meaning you're choosing who you align with in life, I'm gonna be straight here. Like, Cory is my partner for no other reason than he is truly, in my opinion, I believe you're a great man. I believe you're an honorable man.
Thanks, John.
No, truly. And what you say when we're not talking about business, just about whether it be your personal life or your outlook on things, that's how I kind of credentialize who I want on my team. And I've learned through the years through going with, let's say, people who had power or who had money, that's all bullshit, okay? What's real is the realness in people, okay? And that's why I've chosen to align myself with what I believe to be. I believe you're a special person. I was telling your son that, you know, earlier. Like,
it's
the truth. But it is the truth, and that is why I sit by you, I stand by you, and I talk to you every day. And I ultimately believe in you, and I believe in what we can achieve. And I don't know Maurice well, but what I will say is, and you've heard me say this, like, he's one of the few guys.
John was excited when he followed him on Instagram.
Yeah, I called up Corey, I said, dude, Maurice Clarett just followed me on Instagram. I don't give a shit about social media. I do not. I'm not active, but when I see him talk, I feel the realness, okay? So I would not want to be on a stage with someone who I did not feel brought that. So I guess in relation to you, we don't know each other well, but thank you for bringing that to people.
One, I greatly appreciate it. Two, I can say the same thing about Cory. And just even when you describe
Cory. We're going to hug it out.
I do so I say two things. Like, he brought like a reflection in my mind. Like, when you get in business with somebody, it's like getting in bed with them. And this is like, I can't even say this enough. You're marrying that person and so much of your life to that person. And so understanding, and I'm not even good at my own relationship. I feel bad saying this. I got good business relationships, but I'm my own relationship, right? So that's a serious joke. But but on a serious note, when you get in business with somebody, like, it's highly important, like, and I don't even say this jokingly, to know you're doing good business with somebody who's just a good individual, because you can get hooked into the person who has the right words or they can market themselves to you very well initially, but then when you begin to develop and unfold business, things can basically end up another way. And I know you said that from probably like a space of being in somewhere where you're like, man, this isn't what I thought it was before. And so I've been in that space too, but it's very important just to know you have like good solid people around you, you know what I'm saying? So like I would reinforce that. Like, anybody who's looking to go in business with somebody, you know, just make sure the person kind of like internally stand for what you stand for. They have some admirable qualities and that you can basically pull from, and that essentially just help you grow as an individual, because like you can fucking get money with a lot of people. Like, when you start to do business, like, you can get money, it's a thousand ways to get money. Like, you can find a thousand ways to get rich, but having good people you can have good conversations with, invite family over, hang out with, bullshit with, know a person not gonna sneak shit behind your back or try to put some bullshit deal together, like, that stuff means more. Or you know, knowing you have somebody who's not trying to do that to you, you know what I'm saying, it means a whole lot, for whatever it's worth.
So, I think it'd be fun to take some questions, huh?
Absolutely.
So, here's what I want to say before this. This is not high school where no one wants to raise their hand. Like, we really want to help. So, we all would love to answer.
Absolutely.
Business, personal, whatever it is that we can, you know, get in there and really kind of help you guys. I think there's a lot of value in that. And when else can you have us three weigh in truly on it? So, who wants
nothing's
to
out of bounds.
Who wants to be the first question? Oh, I like it. Here, I'm going to go to the other mic. Alex, you want to help get the mic to the next guy?
Yeah, who ain't?
So go ahead, bud. What's your name first?
My name is Brandon. It's a 6-hour drive down from Michigan.
My heart wasn't
beating like 30 seconds ago.
Nice.
So I'll make this as short as possible.
Take your time, man.
Going out too, but I guess I'll start out by saying I'm supposed to be a landscaper. When I say that, I'm supposed to be running a commercial landscaping business that my dad started 33 years ago. That's not my expectation. That was the expectation of growing up by my dad saying, this is going to be yours someday. You know, you've got the same drive, you've got the same work ethic. This is yours if you want it. Well, I don't want it, but I tried it.
Okay.
The best way for me to explain it now, thinking back on it, life is a giant sea, and that business was just this whirlpool of comfort. You knew it was a for sure thing, you knew that tractor was going to for sure be there, but I never wanted to go in there. But that level of being content kind of stuck me right in that whirlpool, and there it was. So I finally got an opportunity to do something of my own. I'm in the Michigan Army National Guard. They offered me a full-time position, and I took it. It was a way for me to finally get out of that expectation and to branch out, do my own thing, make my own name for myself. So this is finally it. It's a full-time position, feeling good, making good money. 6 months into it, they sit me down and said, we don't know how to tell you this, but your position's gonna be gone. Okay, when? 3 weeks from now. So here I am again, no work to find. Trying to get through this here.
You take your time, dude, you're good. Yeah.
So sometimes I just think life has a way of not all in one full picture, but it just gives you pieces and glimpses of what you're supposed to do and what you feel like you want to do at that point in time. And at that time for me, January 6th this year, I drove down to old school.
Hell yeah.
I kept watching the videos, I kept seeing all the hype, and I was just mainly did it looking for inspiration. I've always wanted to open my own gym, I can never find the angle to do it. And then the odds of I go down there January 6th,
I'll bring out of town. Was that there?
No, you're not. You were coming from South Carolina.
Okay. Somewhere, I don't remember. All right, go ahead, my bad.
So the odds that I go down there January 6th, finally pull the trigger, 6 hours and 15 minutes, on Thursday afternoon, January 10th, you guys unveil that you're opening the affiliate program. I mean, that was the first thing that jumped out because I've always wanted to own my own gym. I've never had the angle. This is the angle of how I can do it, though. And then I ran back to the idea to my parents, my family, friends, all that, and same thing you're saying. I believe it, I can do it.
Sure.
Everyone's looking at me now, okay, you're unemployed and this is your answer? Like, this is what you want to do right now? Like, we've all got dreams, but that's like I've won the lottery, money's not an issue type thing. So, but no, that for me, that would be winning the lottery. So I guess my biggest question is, even though in light of I can't see it, but I can feel it, I believe it, how do you take that unknown fear of momentum? I don't know how else to explain it. I've got that feeling rolling right now, but I don't have anything necessarily to put it into. How do you take that feeling of I don't know where to start with it, but this is what I want to do?
So you said it would be like winning the lottery?
Yes.
Okay, so you have to do it.
Yeah.
You have to do it.
I have to.
You have to do it.
I don't think about anything else.
That's it, okay? So how are we going to do it? Banks are there for a reason, right? If you have credit issues, there are websites. That's where technology is great. You can raise money. I don't recommend what they call love money, going to family members, but if you have to, listen, when you wake up in the morning and you are happy, that's what life's about. Whatever that is that makes you happy. So if you're gonna tell me winning the lottery is that, you gotta do it. And guess what? You're not talking about opening a company to compete with Apple. You're right, you're talking about opening up an old school gym, which is reasonable, which is affordable, and I promise you, you can get that money. But I would say exercise options. Do your homework, do some research, get online, find that money, and go ahead.
No, I was gonna say that too. One thing that kind of helped me, and look, I'm going through the same shit. Like, you just feel it and you know it, but one thing that's helped me out, I'm telling you, I got these fucking whiteboards all over my house. Start drawing out your ideas. You know, you sit down and you start drawing out what you need, who you can get it from. You start just drawing out what weights you need in here. Like, what does it take to put together? And when you visually see it, I just think like you get blessed with people in your path to kind of bring the answers to you. You know, I don't know if you believe or not, but I don't believe God basically gives you what you want. I think He gives you the opportunity. And based upon your discipline and commitment, you got to put everything together. And I'm telling you, if you start, like, even if you take those websites he's talking about, start drawing out on the board, and then it becomes real, and then it gets, like, engraved in your brain, and then it gets engraved in the front, and then you start to, like, do it. That's how I did everything I'm doing now. Like, I don't have a college education. I just took ideas, put them on a fucking board, and wrote steps 1 through 30. Like, okay, what's the next step? What's the next step? What's the next step? No difference than here. Like, fucking, I live in Canal, Winchester. I say, Cory, what's the address? I put this shit in my GPS. I just follow the fucking map, but as an entrepreneur, you have to follow your own map, but you have to create it, you know what I'm saying? Off the help.
Now that I'm on the mic, actually, I think I'm way better at that, but I think that's what turns people away is, you know, we get these ideas that go with momentum, but then why not how to do it? And that turns a lot of people away.
What don't you know how to do?
Well, mainly to the point of I've been around business. My dad could probably help me figure out financially how to get started, but on the business end of it, Dustin, how do I get that goal?
So here's, I think, the main thing is what you did, which was awesome, is you did, the first thing is got away from the family business because that ain't you. Because that's hard. Agreed. 33 years. Yep. So even though that opportunity didn't work, you had enough balls to say, I'm out. Yep. Right? And now you had it. Yeah, absolutely. That's big, dude. And then you had the balls to come back and tell them all after you're unemployed, now I'm gonna own a gym. Because it just feels right, right? This is you, this is what you wanna do. Those other things, dude, I had no clue how to do it either. Everybody's the amateur, everybody's the contender. That's part of what will make you get up an hour early, research a little bit more, call Nettie 100 times if that's what you decide to do, create a relationship with whoever you partner with. Like, that's what's gonna make you wanna be great because you don't know. Because I never knew, John never knew.
Believe in you.
Yeah, I mean, believe in you. So it's like, if you got the passion and you want it, this is, because dude, every day I get up, all I want to do is lift weights. All I want to do is create a way to lift weights and get paid. There's nothing's changed for me. At 17, I said, I'm going to lift weights and I'm going to get fucking paid. And at 38, I still get up, it's what I want to do. And I didn't care if anything, no one thought it was possible. Because no one knew anybody that did it until it became, I'm the guy that does it. You know what I mean? That's what I do. And so what it comes down to is like, that's gonna wanna make you be great because you have to find it out. Because I can't tell you exactly. Yeah. There's a path, but it's still gonna be your way, right? So I think that take comfort in that it's unknown. But the key is that most people don't know what they don't know what their lottery is.
Right.
They don't know what their lottery is. I was just blessed that I knew it early. And I was like, I'm gonna hit it. I'm gonna hit it. I'm gonna get money. I'm gonna look like a 90s. I mean, I want to be like a rap star.
One thing I would add is this: you can start living your lottery tomorrow. That's in your blood. You can't deny it. That's your lottery. Start it tomorrow.
Yeah, and I've up to this point, I guess the main thing too with that is you guys don't officially have the application process out for yet.
Yeah, you'll be, stop by and see Nettie tomorrow. She's almost ready to go. So you're biting at the bit, which is awesome.
Yeah.
And then you just gotta turn you loose.
Yeah. Can't lose that.
Like a wild animal, bro.
I put it for 3 times on the site.
Yeah, that's good.
I'm back, yeah,
I think that you're already there. I think you're already there. I think it's just the process. I think that you already got through the hard stuff. You already told everybody in your life that you're not going to do the landscaping, which, by the way, probably could have made you a lot of money.
Again, but.
But that's not it. That's good though. So that's big, dude. Yeah, that's big.
This meant more than.
Yeah, of course. Oh, exactly. All right. Next question. Don't be scared. Hey, what's up? Go ahead, dude.
Thank you. You guys don't know how much you impact everyone. My brother is my partner, and Cory, you have inspired me to get out of my comfort zone, which I'm constantly arguing with my brother. Finally, we're going to the hospital, so you do that.
Abe's a vet, by the way, everybody. Owns two hospitals.
And multiple drug companies don't know John Fosco, but they do know John Fosco. With the art of negotiation, I get on the phone and I say, no, I talked to John Fosco and he says, you can give me a better, for real.
But, I love it.
I'll get you better than
this. So I always say, I just got on the phone with John Fosco and he says, you can do better. But anyway, we're building a new hospital. We're trying to hire new doctors. Have you guys ever used a headhunter firm or hiring professionals? So I know Maurice's got multiple businesses. You guys have gone through multiple businesses that are growing. We've grown too fast. We need to hire people, and it's hard to find doctors or veterinarians to come to a smaller town.
Sure.
So, experience with headhunter firms.
Do you?
So I had a little experience with it, and I don't think it ever worked out.
You're gonna overpay.
I think you overpay, and it is hard to get some big wigs to a small town. I think that.
Mansfield.
Yeah, I think if you're reaching, I think Abe, it's going to take you a little bit more time to find a quality one. But because you're a long-term player, I think that the guys that we brought in, I won't name any names, but I struggled with because they just weren't what we needed. In theory, they were. The process should have been better. I wasn't always the one. When you have a board of directors and things that are making decisions, not just all on you, but I would sit down with guys and. They were supposed to be helping with social media and they didn't even have a fucking Facebook page open. You know what I'm saying? So that's what you get sometimes. So just because they did something at this company and they have that resume, I think that, like I said, it's gonna take a little time and I don't know where these people are. So in your niche, but I wouldn't rush into it. I would find somebody that you know is gonna be there for a decade because that's what you're trying to build, so.
The one thing I would say is this is, even I do it at times, we underestimate the power of the internet. So if you're looking for somebody and there's someone available looking for a job that has a skill set, you guys can both go to the same place, which is where everyone goes, which is the internet. So I think just getting more aggressive maybe in your approach, whether it be through social, whether it be through SEO, every commerce lives online. You know what I'm saying? And a headhunter could specialize, but you gotta remember, anytime there's a middleman, you're paying for them. Even if you're not paying for them, you're paying for them. So I would say use the net to the best of your capability and forget the head.
Well, it would be interesting because if I saw a tour of your facility, if you introduced your wife in summer, which is awesome, if you just showed what you're about, and somebody is like, well, do I want to go to Mansfield? But then they see like, man, this dude's legit. It looks like a great place to work. I'm gonna get paid, and that's hard to do through a headhunter. So it might be a little social, a little bit. There might be a little strategy you just need to create for yourself to try to draw the person in that is gonna be an all-star for you.
Thanks.
Yeah, no problem, man. Next question. Come on. I'm gonna start picking people because I know much of it. It's up, Jacob. I see enough faces that are familiar, so don't get it twisted. I'll start walking out there.
What's up, guys? So I have a question about someone coming up trying to purchase a business. John, I know you're pretty intense.
Nuh-uh.
Can you push it too far? Can you be too intense? Can you drive people away because of how relentless you are?
Yeah. For you 100% can. And anyone who listens to the podcast hears the word leverage a lot. Leverage, to me, is the switch that enables intensity. Without it, you're just a talking head with the volume up way too high. So in a business scenario, listen, intensity, passion, and knowing your shit is important. But you must have some sort of leverage. For example, one of our partners today was asking me about how do you push the price down on supplements? How do you get it cheaper? And I said, well, if we're ordering the same volume, right? Let's say we order 2,000 units, and then we order 2,000 units again. What am I going to do? Say, give me a better price and raise my voice? That's retarded. That's stupid. No, what you need to do is say, listen, okay, we did 2,000 last time. Okay, we're going to do 5,000 this time, but you're going to do it at this price. So you don't ask them, you tell them. Now, they're going to come back with a counter, but that's where you begin the process of getting to a better place and negotiating a better situation for yourself. But without leverage, as Walter White said, tread lightly.
I think too is like the situation. I know you well, so I know your situation, but it's like if I didn't, I would always tell you that you got to know the score, where you're at, how much you mean to the business, how confident you are of what you can do with the business. And I'm always a big believer in, I'm just like they know I'm there. Like, you want to buy this thing, I know you do. So you told them last month. 2 weeks later, you're telling them again. Like, you just let them know, like, I'm not going anywhere, but you're showing value. You're crushing it to where he's got to be thinking, why am I not selling it to this guy? And I know you're a workaholic, just like all of us. So it's like the stuff that you're doing and displaying and the way that you're doing in the business, this guy's not thinking it's going to anyone else. You leave him no choice that the 15th time you jab his ass, he's going to be like, I got to sell it.
There's a thousand ways to say the same thing, and because we're all made up differently, you could tell me the same thing and word it differently on the 30th time and get me. That's why that pressure that Cory just talked about is key. But you pressure people with respect, and I think self-deprecation literally helps if you're going to keep on it.
And we both do it in different ways. John's really good at making people just slightly uncomfortable. He's good at it. I've seen it, but it works every time. I'm not so good at that. I end up becoming everybody's best friend. You know what I mean? It just happens. But we still can negotiate in different ways. Our personalities are different, but you gotta find out whatever, you might be in between the two somewhere, right? But like that value at the end of the day, if I see a guy just killing it, and I'm an OG, and I'm about to sell out, I start to become his fan. I'm a fan of him. I mean, you know what I mean? So when it does hit the 30th time, you're going to find a strategy for her to get out because you're like, this is the guy. I mean, there can't be undeniably anybody else. That's my thing. Reese, you got anything to add to that?
No, one thing that popped in my head, I was just talking about, I think people may overlook just understanding culture and business. You know, there's different culture, different people, how people may have been raised. And I think more is in delivery, you know, how you deliver and what you're saying. I think we don't, I think we start talking about the art of deal making. You start speaking more of mechanics of doing it. And I just think culturally, when we start to understand where people may be from, body language, who they are, I think prison helped me with that. Just dealing with mass amounts of people from different backgrounds, socioeconomics, different places, but just exposing yourself to more of who you're around, just understand who you're talking to, and finding commonalities. You know, that's why I like to watch TV. I mean, I like to read the news a lot, just socially be aware, but it just gives different points of engagement to get to people. And the next thing you know, you're like you say, you find out your value in the business, and you figure out, you know, I can leverage the shit out of this. And in certain places, I can get aggressive. In certain places, where I can, you know, be a little bit smoother. You know, I don't know if that makes sense, but
it's like a true strategy. It's like you're playing chess.
Culture, man.
You got to be a chameleon. I mean, that's essentially it. That's the biggest thing in sales. You got to be able to shape shift. You're always, whether you're doing business or not, you're dealing with people. So when you're dealing with people, people are wired in one way, they're human beings. So what Maurice said is great advice, because dig into their background, find out if they have kids, you know, find out about their parents, their brothers, just know that stuff, because then you have a better picture of how to speak to them.
Next question. Oh, we got three hands all at the same time. All right, I don't know this guy, so we'll go with him.
This question for Maurice. Big Ohio State fan. I went to your first game against Texas Tech.
Okay,
nice.
A ridiculous game. My question isn't really related to business or anything, but what was it within you when Miami picked the ball off toward the end zone and you ran after the dude and you were able to get the ball back?
I got lucky. It looked like a loaf of bread, didn't it, Reese?
No, so I think a lot of it, and as silly as it sounds a lot, it was a more entertaining watching it than anything. But I think when you're competing, I just think subconsciously you hit a switch where you say, I'm not going to lose. And as soon as it happened, I was just like, I got to go get the ball back. You know, and so TV makes it look cute, and I'm not like a real good announcer. You see, I talk real raspy. So I'm not like going to describe it like in this cool way, you know what I'm saying? But like you just you don't want to lose, you know what I'm saying? And nothing like that catch or the strip is like symbolic to my life. You just don't want to lose no matter what goes wrong or what you fuck up or what you lose, you just don't want to lose. And so you just grab the ball back from your life, you grab the ball back from another person, but just whatever it is, like even with him, when he starts talking, he's going to figure like, I'm not going to lose with what I'm about to go into. No matter what comes up. And so like, it was nothing more than that. You know, the story behind it was that Craig Crimson was trying to throw a championship touchdown to his buddy. serious. Like, if you go back and watch the film, the guy on the left side of the field was open. You know, the person who he supposed to throw the ball to was open. You know what I'm saying? But he tried to give his buddy a touchdown. And I was just like, fuck it, you want to win. But you know, you make it that far, you get to the fucking championship and you know, you get lost in the moment. You know, you're out there, and just, I mean, it's a big moment. You know, everybody creates like a big stage for themselves. You know what I'm saying? But the shit that you do to practice and all that stuff shows up when it's time to perform. And who you are comes out, you know what I'm saying? If you condition yourself to be a loser or get off that treadmill like 27 seconds or give up or just like, you know, if you just condition yourself to give up, man, that shit is gonna be like, be a fucking give up type of person. You know what I'm saying? Like, people don't become losers on accident. You know what I'm saying? But and winners don't become winners on accident. It's like, it's not luck. Like, I remember when you first started this, you know what I'm saying? How many times did I tell you? I said, oh, this shit's nothing. I already knew what he was going to do. He didn't see it because he's living it, but I see it. I was like, oh, fuck, you got so much damn discipline. It's just a matter of time. Yeah, it's just serious. You know what I'm saying? But winners are winners for a reason, and losers are losers for a reason. Not to call my head a loser, but losing behavior. Not to say individually. Let me clarify that. I don't call people losers, but behavior that may be loser-ish. You know, people create these habits. And so I don't know if that's a question.
I'm gonna finish this question though. So it was Sean Taylor, wasn't it?
Yeah, Sean Taylor.
Did it just look like it was just beaming?
No,
Reese, so literally it was just like.
No, so what happened was so every day of football practice, a discipline again. Every day of football practice, the first thing you do is ball security before you do anything else. And so we do drills teaching you how to hold the ball. So when I seen with the football, the first thing is that you're not supposed to have any air. If he's going right here, he's going like this. So subconsciously, just through conditioning myself from preparation, I was like, oh, I'm supposed to fucking carry it. He carried it the wrong hand.
That's exactly what he thought, probably, dude.
Yeah, so let me clear this up to you. I feel bad all the time because he lost his life. For those who don't know, the gentleman unfortunately lost his life, so I kind of feel like we're talking about it all the time, you know what I'm saying? But it popped in my mind, like he's carrying the ball wrong, in the wrong hand, and I have a chance to get it back. Like, happen that fast. Just preparation.
So cool. Yeah. Dane, who are you next? Go ahead.
Yeah, kind of goes along with this question, when he was talking about getting people to believe and everything. For those of you who don't know, a couple guys know me here. I'm a fireman on the northwest side of Dayton. And being the youngest guy that works on my department, I've seen firsthand what 15, 20, 30 years of guys not taking care of their bodies, line calls all night and day, you know, does it feel. So for me, I kind of wanted to start something, you know, more geared toward public safety, just, you know, personal training, things like that, letting guys know different things that, you know, that they can do to help you know, better prepare themselves, take care of themselves, everything. So, you know, my financial situation is, you know, if I want to just keep it like it is, it's fine. I'm making it, I'm supporting my kids. Just had a baby 9 months ago, my wife, you know, my house, and, you know, the cookie cutter family, whatever. So it's not that I need to go do something, you know, I really feel like that if I helped, you know, I can make an impact in this way. But how do you present, and you know, all you guys, this question is really for all you guys, how do you present that question to your spouse when really, it kind of sounds like a crazy idea, like, hey, let's devote some of this time, some of our time, you know, because she knows it's going to affect her too. How do you devote some of that time, some of our time, to something that we really don't need to do, but I feel inside me that it's kind of like almost like a passion and a drive to help other people, to help these guys I'm working with. You know, how I present that idea, you know, not that I don't think my spouse wouldn't support me in whatever, you know, venture I want to go down, but how do you kind of present that, you know, muster up that, I guess, you know, enough faith.
Well, I've had to present a lot of crazy shit to my wife over the last 20 years. That's for damn sure. I think that a couple different things, Dane. It's like you're not saying I'm going to quit my job tomorrow to do this, which I've done a couple times. So it's like, in that regards, I always thought like, and this is a little bit less of a dice roll, but I always thought like I had to roll the dice big once to just see if I had it. Just see like, because I didn't want to have a regret later in life and think I never tried. You just don't want to get older and regret that you didn't do it, or at least try it. I mean, that to me, and if they love you and they know how passionate you are about it, they're going to try to work with you to make it happen. She might not say, I'm cool with 10 hours a week, but you might meet at 7. And I think it's almost like any other thing that it's your business partner. You just got to go to her like that and say, like, this is just inside me. I got to do it. But I'm all about not settling. I think it would be one of the worst things ever.
My whole family is settled.
Yeah.
You know, I'm the first one to go to college and stuff like that. I've always been that one to kind of, to what I've ever been. My family, like Reese said, like, I've always been like, I want to be better than you.
Yeah.
So I take my whole family and be like, you know, I want to be better than my whole family. You know, yep. It's bad to some people as that sounds, you know, I want to be that person. So
yeah.
Not settling is my whole idea. That's my whole, I'm taking my family and I want to be everything that my family.
Sure.
To clarify, this venture you're talking about is a venture to help people understand safety better?
No. Take guys more of public safety, more of personal training, you know, to do with diet, nutrition, and everything, to go along with that, more geared toward public safety.
So it is a, let's say, a revenue-generating venture?
Correct.
Okay. But you're... purpose and your passion to do it is to better prepare these people?
Physically, mentally, yeah.
Okay, so I think anytime you're trying to truly, if it's your truth, help people be more prepared, you're trying to help people, I would lead with that if you're talking about trying to onboard your wife. You're trying to help people.
Right.
In life, I don't know what's more valuable or what should carry more weight than trying to help people. So if that's truly where you're coming from and you lead with that, not only will she most likely be on board with it because I don't know if you're religious or not, it's God's work, but you're going to be successful at it because you're doing it for the right reason. You're not talking about, oh, I can make more money. No, you're talking about helping people and making them more efficient. So kudos. Number one, and number two, do it.
Yeah, but I was gonna say, again, delivery is service. I'm bringing service, and this is sort of like service work to these people to improve the quality of their performance, things in that capacity. But another thing that helps, and when I was talking about bad relationships problems, like, I'm not like Cory, I have a horrible time scheduling, but some of the best times that I've had success in my relationship is when I schedule everything and allow my lady to see it and support it. You know what I'm saying? So, like, as an entrepreneur, you make a bunch of stuff in your mind and you become totally disconnected and you live in the world, but the person next to you wants to be involved in what you're doing. And so, like, if you can start to draw it out and sell the vision, you know, you gotta have a vision for it. It's not just like an idea, this is a vision of what I wanna do. And it's the service I want to bring to these other people, and you can figure out some way how to involve them. I've just had better experiences telling her what I'm going to do and letting her be involved than when I just cut her off. Like, I was like, hey, I'm not going to be home for 4 days. And so it was cool because I said, I'm not going to be home for 4 days because this is what I'm doing. And then when it makes sense, like, okay, shit makes sense. He's not going to fuck around, you know what I'm saying? But he's going to do good work. So that's the thing I want to add to it.
I keep, like, I don't like to tell Rach every idea because some of, you know, I like to get her all excited that I'm trying to do like 9 things. So I try to make sure that, like, they're at least like over the edge a little bit. Then I bring it to her. I brought some crazy ones. All right, next.
Those quality relationships and business and your personal life and balance all three. So those are important.
I think that, like, I was you guys forever, right? Like, meaning, like, I still am. I always think about being a personal trainer, being the guy buying from Europa, not selling the products to Europa, selling the products to GNC, the guy walking in GNC back in those days, the guy that was, you know, looking for somebody to teach me, or just, I'm just so still happy that people are emailing me to ask me things. Why would I not? Like, I just don't, I think, have this this thing that people get when they get some sort of success that they're just so sweet. ET is like, why do you think you're so sweet? That's what he's telling me. We were being, John wouldn't watch them. It's like, I just try my best. Like, I'm a very confident person. I believe that you can sit me in a room with anybody. I performed at the highest level in my industry with Arnold. When I met with Tiger, he asked me how Arnold was doing. Like, I wasn't even nervous. I believe that I can be that way. But at the end of the day, like, I'm gonna go back to my rap. I'm Paul Wall, man. I'm like the people's champ. Like, to me, like, it's like, to me, it's like, that's everything. Like, I'm a gym guy that I care about every member. I want these guys to win. Like, if you're gonna take time to think that I'm some sort of authority in my profession, I'm not just gonna, like, overlook your email. I am really busy. Rachel will tell you, like, I'm trying to get everyone answered by the time I go to bed. Sometimes I run out of time, sometimes I miss it, and sometimes guys are emailing me 20 times and maybe the 21st time I'll call them just randomly. I do a lot of that stuff too because I just feel so blessed that I get to do what I want to do every day. Once again, I just want to lift weights. That's it, and impact people. It's really that simple. And so I impacted you, I can tell. But it's just part of what I think if I do that enough every day consistently. And so yes, you need to answer your clients because they feel the same way you feel right now about you. You know what I mean? And so, like, if we all do that, then you just, the amount of positivity that can hit is massive. And so, like, you know, look, we put this thing on. I was just hoping somebody showed up. I really still think that. I don't think, well, damn, we're definitely gonna get 100 people at home. I just don't feel that way every day. I just feel blessed to do what we do, and staying humble is the key, you know? But don't get it twisted. When somebody tests me, I know I can hold my own at the highest level because of preparation. Because that ball does look like this when I'm in my wheelhouse. When I step up to the platform, I'm ready to go at it. Or if my guys are there, I'm coaching them like we're in a fight. Like, I have that switch. Y'all have seen it before. But at the end of the day, man, I just truly love it. So the impact is, I feel blessed to hear it. So thank you. Thanks for saying that.